thank you so much for being here with us today. We want to thank all of you who have taken time to be here. Some have traveled a pretty good distance. Some have come from both family and probably some friends from out of state. And so we thank you for being here. For those of you who don't know, I'm Mike Crowder, the pastor here for 34 years. Dave and Cheryl have been a part of our church for how many years? 20? 20 years. And of course, the kids. And so we're all very emotionally connected to everything. This family is very loved here. Very, very loved. Pastor Rob, our executive pastor, will facilitate the memorial service today per the program that you have in front of you. We want to begin with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you again today for David's life. We are disheartened that it was cut so short and so tragically, and we have been grieving that. We will continue to process that for a long time to come. None more impacted, obviously, than the family, specifically the immediate family, a wife and children. But as been said before, we are processing all of this on the foundation of our faith, the confidence in our hope in you, the realization that David has been enjoying eternal life without the human frailty and hindrances that so easily beset us still today on this earth. So we are confident in our faith, but still grieving in our heart. And today, as we honor Dave's life, which is worthy of honor for sure, the depth of his love for people is reciprocated by the depth of love people have for him. And that will be expressed today by family and friends alike, and we on the pastoral staff. We love you, Lord, and we ask that you'll help each one today as we process this mixture of joy and sadness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right. We are going to have a reading from John chapter 14, verse 1 through 4. John chapter 14, verse 1 through 4. This was a scripture that was David's favorite scripture. It will also be partly what we do the message on today in a moment. But if you follow along with me, if you have your Bibles, or if you just want to follow along with me in prayer, John 14, 1 through 4, it says, "Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, and trust also in me," Jesus says. "There is more than enough room in my Father's home. If this were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? When everything is ready, I'll come and get you, so that you'll always be with me where I am, and you know the way to where I'm going." Praise God for that. Amen, church. Amen. To continue to celebrate, and that is really our goal today, is to, we're going to face a lot of tough emotions and everything, but we're also here to celebrate his life. And to do that, we are going to have several family members and even friends who are going to share stories and testimonies or whatever it may be of how much David touched their life. And so at this time, I want to invite, and I will invite each person up, but at this time, I want to invite Leonard Carrillo, his brother-in-law, to come up and share about the impact that David had on his life.
Good morning. I get to kick this thing off. Thank you very much for coming. And, I will do my best. I looked up the definition for celebration, which is that's what this is, celebration. And the definition says to show admiration for someone or something in a piece of writing, music, art, and ceremony. So that's what we're here for today for. And so I'm very glad you guys are here. I'm glad to be here. My sister and Dave and the family's been here for how many years? 20 years. I've never been here. I've been to the airport a few times, but I've never been here. So it took Dave to get me here. So we can thank Dave for that. All right. Well, today we're going to laugh because Dave made us laugh. We're going to cry because we loved him. Take you on a little time machine. I first met Dave when we were in youth group. Dave was 2 years older than me. We started attending Orangefell Assembly of God in California. And I would say Dave was, right off the bat, one of the most delightful persons I've ever met. Very confident. That word confident keeps coming back to me. Because even at his young age, he was very, very, very confident. You can probably accredit his upbringing. But he was a very, very confident young man. Fast forward. My sister moves up from Madera, California, where she was going to where she was going to Fresno State, and she started attending church with the family. And the details are a little sketchy, but I'm not sure how they started dating. I asked Cheryl yesterday with at lunch how did they meet, and they met in this singing group called the Revived Generation. Dave loved to sing. And he was a very, very good singer. But Dave, this well-groomed, tall and slender, perfectly feathered hair, drove a brand new Ford T-Bird, green, started dating my sister. That's not bad. And he was a very, very delightful young man. Fast forward, my sister's walking down the aisle to give her hand in matrimony to this young man. Thus, the journey begins. This tall, well-groomed, slender, perfectly feathered hair. How many remember feathered hair? Okay, I remember it. When I used to have it. But Dave always had, he was immaculately groomed, just a delightful, delightful guy. I think a lot of Dave. I don't know if you guys knew this, but he was a master welder. Master welder and fabricator, okay? And I presented him with a number of different projects over the years. And one of the things that I always remember him doing, when I would give him this sheet of paper with a scribble on it to say, Dave, can we do this? And he would look at it and he would go, I think we can do this. I think we can do this. And I would show up later, a few days later, a week later, whatever, and it was done. And it was done impeccably. Dave never did anything half-baked. Story I was telling Dan, his son, yesterday. I had a vehicle that had a diesel leak. And I went to Dave and I said, Dave, the diesel tank is leaking, little drops in my driveway. What do you think? So he crawls up under there and he goes, yeah, we got to take that thing out. I said, okay. I said, all right, what do we need to do? He goes, well, we won't know until we take it out. So we took it out, we drained it out. He says, yeah, he says, I can't tell, I don't know what's going on. He says, let me take it to work. Now Dave worked at, was it McClellan? McClellan, okay. He was in a kind of a top secret room where they worked on certain airplanes, F-15s or whatever they worked on. He never told me what he did. But he took that tank And he brought it back about 4 days later, and I said, so what was the problem? I said, I looked at that tank. I said, Dave, that thing looks brand new. He said, did you buy me a brand new tank? Which I knew he wouldn't have. I said, did you give me a brand new tank? He goes, no, no. He says, let me tell you the process. He was so excited. He says, we took the tank. He says, we boiled it in this solution to get all the crud out. He says, then we did a pressure test on it. He says, there was these hundreds of little tiny holes in it. He says, so it's not something that we could just, you know, spot weld. He says, there were hundreds of these things. He says, so what we did, we took sheets that they use on the space shuttle, and we welded them to the tank. And I said, what? He says, you got space shuttle technology on that tank. I said, Dave, what did that cost? He goes, well, you know what? It's funny. Those sheets were about $10,000 a piece. He said, but don't worry about it. They were scraps. So we put the tank back on, got it working. He says, hey, you got a Mercedes now that's got space shuttle technology to it. That's just one little story. I was rehearsing with a jazz band that I play in, and Wednesday night that I got the phone call. My wife came and she says, "Hon, you got to call your sister." And I said, "What's going on? Just tell me. Just tell me." She goes, "Dave's gone." What? Dave Sligar cannot be gone. Dave Sligar cannot be gone. I called my sister. What a rock. What a rock. She was comforting me. She was comforting me. And I want to thank the church for taking care of my sister and her family. That's what we do. That's a biblical mandate. That is the biblical mandate. And I appreciate that very, very much. And I appreciate you guys for being here.
At this time, I want to invite Randy. Another brother, as you can assume.
The younger and the better looking one. Thank you for coming on behalf of my sister and her family. I appreciate you guys being here. And as my brother said, this church has been incredible to my sister and her family over this very, very tragic event. I can't even, how do you explain it? To tell people that we live with what even happened is like, it's not even a story that makes sense. But here we are. So I'm going to go back a little bit. Our stories are going to cross over a little bit because that's just kind of how Dave was. When I first met Dave, he was singing in the group that I was singing in. And David was very immaculate. He took care of himself. He cared about himself. A couple of points that David taught me was one about cleanliness and brushing your teeth. His mother will agree with this part. Dave said, people don't brush their teeth correctly. They need to brush their teeth, and they never brush their tongue. They need to brush their tongue because that's where all the germs are. Do you remember him saying that? Oh. David would walk around, show up for all of our singing practices, all of our rehearsals, with a toothbrush in his mouth. It's crazy. But he was very concerned about that kind of thing. When I was thinking about what I was going to say and how I was going to say it, I said, Dave, if I'm going to talk about you, what would I say? What would I say? And I heard this small voice say, tell him about my hair. My brother brought it up. He loved his hair. He loved his hair. Look at those pictures. He had great hair, and he had really great hair when he was young. Dave was just quirky about things like that, but it was kind of fun. He was a giver, such a giver. I was a music director of our church for many, many, many years, and Dave had the best tenor voice that we had in church. So, of course, whenever I would plan a production, I would say, Dave, I've got this really hard song, and you're singing it. Dave never said no to me. He would never say no. He'd go, okay, I'll do it, I'll do it. He was well known for an Easter song. It was called Peter's Song, and it was a song where he would sing, and it would talk about the betrayal of what Peter did, and Dave got so emotional, and he always cried. He always cried. It really wasn't designed to do that, but Dave would just cry because he sang. When Dave sang, he cried. It was very special to all of us, and it was very moving. So Dave is known for singing Peter's Song in our Easter productions. One year, I heard this really challenging song that I wanted to use in the Easter production, but Jesus had to sing it. It had to be sung by the character playing Jesus. So I went to Dave, and I said, Dave, I got a song for you. I want you to listen to it. And he listened to it, and he said, oh, that's a really good song. Yeah, I'd like to sing it. I'd like to sing it. I said, okay, good. I said, here's the only problem, Dave. You got to be Jesus. And our productions back in the day, we had full-blown productions and Jesus hung on the cross. We hung him on the cross. He had the long wig. Dave's rolling through all this in his mind, and he goes, wait a minute. You're not putting me on that cross, and I'm not wearing that thing around my waist. That's not happening. I'm never doing that. No, I'm never doing that. So we had to end up doing, if you remember this, you probably don't even remember this, we had another guy act out Jesus, and we had Dave sing it off to the side. Those kind of crazy things happened all the time. Dave was a handyman, and Dave did all kinds of amazing things. I look forward in our recent years of my sister and Dave coming to visit us in Sacramento, and they would come and spend a week with us or so, and Dave would spend the majority of his time on the couch watching movies. It was almost like a movie marathon. How many movies could he actually watch while he was at my house? You asked Dave what he did when you went to California. What'd you do? He probably told you other things, but he was really laying on my couch watching movies. That's all he really did. He had a routine. He'd get up really early in the morning. We would get up, and we'd find him gone. We knew where he was. He was at the donut shop. He went and got a donut and came back home. After that, he would go, and he would end up at Home Depot or Lowe's or HD Supply, because that's where he loved to be. He could spend hours walking around Lowe's and HD Supply in those stores. It's crazy. I would come up with projects. I'd say, we got to come up with a good project for Dave, because we got to get him off the couch. So while he's here. So I would come up with walls that needed to be torn down or screen doors that needed to be installed or little things like that. Dave always did it. He did it. And he would leave after being a week at my house, and I'd have this amazing project done. The fun part about it was also, if he didn't find a tool that he needed or a tool that wasn't to his liking, he'd go buy it. And then he'd leave me these great tools. So I have some great tools at my house that Dave actually purchased. He was a great guy. He gave a lot. I especially loved how he loved my sister. He cared about her. He loved his children. I told some of you stories last night as we were talking. Most of our time, while he was there with us in Sacramento, he talked about you guys. He loved talking to me, and he would talk about you. And he would share his concerns about each of you that he had. And of course, I would always give him advice. It's just like I'm still giving you advice today. I would always give him advice. My favorite statement, Dave would say, what is wrong with them? Can you hear him saying that? What is wrong with them? I loved him. We're going to miss him. He was a great guy. He was a great guy. You guys had a very special dad. Those quirkiness, that funny character, that guy that just made us laugh. Dave, honestly, I don't think he really thought he was funny, but he was funny, and he would say funny things. When he realized that he said something that was funny, he would get the biggest grin on his face, and he'd smile, and he'd laugh, because he thought, wow, that was funny. I really said that, and it was funny. He loved to get Cheryl stirred up. He could do it so easily, too. His children will take on that trait. They'll take care of that for us. We don't have to worry about that because they still do it. He was a special, special, special man. And he loved his mother. He loved his mother very much. And we had many conversations about how he cared for you and was concerned about you and wanted what was best for you. Someone you love, someone you comes into your life, touches your life, and it means something to you, and then they're gone. What do we have? We have the hope, knowing where he is. No more ailments, no more aches, no more pains, no more my legs are killing me. We don't have to hear that anymore. He doesn't have to feel it. And he's singing in some quartet, I promise you, because he loved to sing.
This time I want to invite Wes Crosby, who is David's best friend.
Dave was like a brother. He was a business partner and a best friend. December 4th. 2019 changed my world forever. December 4th, 2019, we suffered one of the greatest losses in this world. 1994 to 2000, I worked at a company called Carbon Fiber until they went out of business, and I loved everything that I learned and what I did. And a little later, 2009, I took a composites class at the Davis ATC where I had an instructor named David. And Damon was not the best instructor. He was very rarely around and very rarely could help us with what we needed. Damon took a day off and we had a fill-in instructor, Dave Sligar, show up. Dave changed the class and everybody's life in that class. As far as everything we'd known, Dave came back and retaught us and showed us the correct way to do things. The first night that I worked with Dave, Dave stayed 2 hours after to teach me all the things that I was doing incorrectly or that I didn't understand. Dave had work early in the morning as he worked at Hill Air Force Base. As Dave would work at his shifts, he would also come in on the other shifts to help us out. He didn't only help me, he helped everybody in the class. Anybody who had an interest or wanted to learn, Dave would teach. Me and Dave spent a lot of time together and found that we had a lot in common. We both loved composites, we both loved breakfast, we both loved Chinese buffets a lot. And we loved little adventures, and we both drove almost the same Ford truck. After my class was done, Dave would invite me back to come help him. Even though I was an instructor, Dave would give me an instructor coat, and I would come in and help him during our class. Will Pierce was the guy over the program who came in several times and thought that I was one of Dave's instructors, although I never was. Later on, Dave was promoted to head instructor, and Will Pierce offered me Dave's night shift job because what Dave had taught me was more than any of the other instructors' knowledge of what we were doing. After a while of instructing together, me and Dave started several projects at the Davis ATC and didn't have time to complete them, so we decided it was time to do something else. Dave retired from Davis ATC and I quit. A composite company went out of business and the equipment became available. Me and Dave immediately jumped on it. That day, Dave went down and started loading the truck full of the composite equipment that we would take up to a shop in Harrisville and start to build our own shop and do our own composites. The adventures that me and Dave had took us from Oceanside picking up equipment, leaving Thanksgiving night at 8 o'clock and driving 36 hours straight to driving to Vernal in 12 hours and back to get pieces of equipment we needed to continue the process. We moved a 30-foot autoclave from Sky Park to our new building with just me and Dave. Dave was determined and Dave was proud of everything that we did. Dave made friends with everyone. The owner of the building that we bought the building from owned the building next to us, and his name was Sean Hart. And Dave and Sean Hart became best friends also. They became such great friends that Sean passed away. Dave spent 3 or 4 days going through Sean's stuff, rebuilding all of his trophies for his celebrational life. Dave and Sean spent a lot of time together. I worked full-time and I worked overtime, so I couldn't be there a lot. But the days that I was there, that they were there, they were always happy and laughing. Half the time I couldn't even understand what they were saying, but I had to laugh too because it was so funny that whatever they were laughing about got me involved. Dave spent all day and Dave spent all night at the shop. When I was there, Dave was with me. When I wasn't there, Dave was alone. Dave was always at the shop. Thank you, Cheryl. Because without Cheryl, this never would have worked. Cheryl had the understanding that Dave needed to do what he loved, and he was there more than he was home. Dave loved his family. Dave loved his wife, Cheryl, very much. And Heather. And when Dan lived in California, when Dan would bring the kids up, that was it. Dave would shut everything down for however long that the kids were there because he loved the grandkids and couldn't spend enough time with them. So, Dave also loved Gino and Jen and Emmy. And Emmy could melt Dave's heart with a smile. Anything she ever wanted, Dave could never say no to any of the grandkids. Until later on when he wished he would have said no, but he could never say no. Dave loved his mother, and Dave loved his brother and his uncle Eugene. And when they moved from California to Utah, Dave was such a happier person to have his whole family here. It was absolutely amazing. Dave and his brother Rich spent many, many hours at the shop working on projects and trying to help us get things moving along. Everywhere we went, Dave took his little office things, his airplanes, his picture of him signed by everybody, a picture of his mom and brother when they were younger, and a picture of his family. Dave loved his dogs. Before Dave could come to work every morning, Dave had to get up, go on an early morning walk with the dogs, and go find breakfast somewhere. Dave was a people person, and he loved to make friends with everything. Dave taught me everything I know about composites, but more than he ever taught me about composites, he taught me about forgiveness and how much better life was when you didn't hold hate and anger against people. And I had a lot of hate and anger when I met Dave, and Dave helped me through a lot of things in my life. Dave taught me to forgive and forget, even if it hurt your pride or your ego. Dave was a truly happy person. Dave was willing to help anyone in need or anybody that needed help. Dave would give the shirt off his back to anybody, whether he knew him or not. If they were in need, Dave wanted to help everyone all the time. Dave passed away in the service of others. Dave had a lot of wear and tear on his body from a lifetime of work and being a master welder. Dave would work until his hands and feet could no longer take the pain. Then he would go home, sleep for a while, and do it all again. Dave's pain would keep him up at night to the point that half the time he didn't sleep more than 2 or 3 hours at a time, and he was still willing to get up and do whatever needed to be done the next day. In all the time that me and Dave worked together, we never had one argument, one yelling match, or one fight. Either I backed down or Dave backed down, but we had such a good friendship that it didn't matter. We were going to make the partnership work forever, and it did. This brings us back to December 4th, 2019. Dave will be remembered, and Dave will be loved by many people. I find peace in knowing that Dave no longer feels the pain. And I miss Dave. Dave will be in my heart, and I know that I'll see him again. I love Dave like a brother, and I miss him. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Wes. Thank you, Wes. All right, sis. At this time, Heather Sligar. one of David's incredible kids is going to share something.
I will try and get through this the best I can. Like Rob said, I am one of three children. I'm the youngest of my mom and dad. I wanted to tell you a little bit that my life growing up, I always told myself that I am so much like my mom because I refuse to be like my dad. Not that he was a terrible man or anything, but the little quirkiness in his forgetfulness, I'm like, that's not me, that's not gonna be me. But to be honest, that is completely me. My dad and I, we were so much alike. It scared me sometimes. And because we're so much alike, we got on each other's nerves so much. And there were many times where I had to tell my father, I just need you to go away and just leave me alone. And he'd tell my mother, I don't think Heather loves me. But I reassured him I did. My dad was everything to me. One thing that was always the same and constant between my dad and I, and really my siblings and my dad and I, was our sense of humor. Our relationship consisted of many jokes and funny memories, anything to keep us laughing. My dad was never the disciplinary dad, but always the fun dad. Sometimes when my mom would say no, I'd go to my dad and he'd be like, oh, mom said no? And I'm like, yeah. And he says, that's okay, we don't have to tell her. I love that so much about my dad. And that's how it was with him and I, always making deals under the table and always laughing at each other. That was important in our relationship, that him and I could have that banter back and forth. We never got too offended. I can't even begin to tell you the sadness that embodied my life the moment I found out he was gone. My dad was a real hero. Someone you could depend on and look up to. He was funny, loyal, generous, and observant. One of his greatest joys in life was serving others. He would do anything to help someone get ahead in life. And that is one trait that I hope that I can carry on from my father. That is one trait that I'm proud to have from my father. The earliest memory I had with my dad was the time I was in second grade. I came home from school and I asked my dad if he could install a tetherball set. He looked at me funny and he said, Heather, I built you a treehouse and I set up a basketball hoop for you. Why do you need a tetherball set? It was a really random sport, but it was like the sport of the 90s. And I told him, Dad, I have to beat the boys at school during recess, so I need this tetherball set. And I begged him, because my mom said no. So I had to beg him. And shortly after that conversation, he went and installed the tetherball pole with the ball and string attached to it. I played for hours with my brother, and I played with my cousins who lived right next door to us. The day I beat the boys during recess, I couldn't wait to get home to tell my dad. He was so excited for me, and he told me, there's nothing I wouldn't do for you, Heather. And there were no truer words that came out of his mouth. My dad built my brother and I go-karts when we were kids. He took us to see Sacramento Kings basketball games. He let us do what my mother said we couldn't. He was a confidant to my sister and her teenage troubles. He meant so much to us. The last conversation I had with my dad was on December 3rd, 2019. I told my dad I was probably going to take a sick day at work because I had strep throat and I had no voice. And that morning, he called me after he left the house, and he said, "Heather, I'm on my way to the shop, but I can turn around and get you anything you need if you want." And I thought that was a really special conversation. And I'd give anything for one more conversation with him. But like my uncles talked about, like what Wes talked about, we know that we have this hope that he's in heaven and we'll always have him and his memories in our heart. And until we meet again, we love you, Dad.
Thank you, Heather. Thank you, Leonard. Thank you, Randy. Thank you, Wes. Thank you, Heather. Fantastic words. At this time, the family compiled some pictures and some music that meant a lot to David and to them, and some of our sound booth technicians were kind enough to put something together. So check this out for the next little bit.
Shepherd, I shall not want. time won't matter anymore. You'll land. I'm longing for you, and so.
I want to thank Ed for in our sound booth for putting that together, and the family for taking time to go through all of those pictures and do that today. I have a brief 80-minute message I want to share with y'all today. I'm just kidding. It's only 75 minutes. I love this family. I love this family so much. You guys arrived here in Utah in 1999. Right after you, I arrived. And I've known Heather and Dan for a very, very long time and gotten to know Jen and Gino. And Cheryl, you've entrusted me to work with your kids. Man, On behalf of the family today, I want to thank you so much for being here today. I want to welcome you to our service and everything we're doing. We're here to celebrate the life of David Sligar, known as Davy Bear by those who loved and knew him. They told me to say it. I swear I wasn't going to do it. Davy Bear, come on. Dave was taken far too soon. But the reason this is a celebration of life is because we know that death is not the end. Amen, church. Rather, it's the beginning of eternity. And the passing of a loved one is often unexpected and difficult thing for many of us to deal with. But my prayer is, through the message today, through the talks from family, through everything, that the peace of God will be real in your heart and in your life today. Paul wrote in Philippians that the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Jesus himself said in the Gospel of John, "Peace I leave to you, my peace I give to you, not as the world gives do I give to you. Do not let your hearts be troubled." We're going to say that a few times today. No, let it be fearful. On behalf of the family, I'd like to say a special thank you for those that are, I see a lot of individuals who have been friends for years, who've taught at LCA, who've moved, who came back here. All of you are so special to them and to us, and we thank you so much from the bottom of my hearts to be here. Extended family, cousins, everybody. I've known the Sligar family for some time. I've had the pleasure of working, like I said, with many of them for a great time. I think our relationship is much more than a pastor or a church member. I consider it a friendship. I remember the night of December 4th. I don't really get a Wednesday night off very often. I happen to not be doing anything. I remember telling my wife I was really excited to sit down and eat dinner by myself. I had warmed up my dinner. I sat down. I got a call from Rory, who works in our office. And she was frantic. And I didn't need to hear anything other than David Sligar. I said, "Okay," grabbed my keys, and I was gone. And I was there a minute or two later. And couldn't believe it. Couldn't believe it. Everyone I talked to, absolute shock. This family means the world to me. I consider them friends. I loved Dave. Anytime he would stop by in the hallway, he'd walk up. I'll mention this in a little bit, but he would stop by and he'd say hi to Marcia very, very often. He loved Marcia. But he would often stop by. And the only thing he'd say is, "Hey, Rob." And that was about it. We're like, "Hey, Dave. All right." And he'd wave and go on. He had the best smile. My gosh, he had a good smile. Incredible smile, incredible man. We all love him, and my heart breaks for this family. This is a hardworking and sacrificial man. He had a great laugh. He had a deep love for family. His ability to fix and everything was even considered all the way up until that day that I was there with you guys, where we couldn't help but think, Cheryl and everybody couldn't help but think about the deck and the different things, because his hands were in everything. He was always fixing, always working on something. There's something that David was always working on. And as I thought about it, as I was going through listening to the pictures, seeing the pictures and everything, I was running through the scripture of John 14 in my mind, and this is a fabrication guy, as Wes is talking about, to which I was touched by. Wes, your story was, I was so touched by yours. I loved everyone, but I was particularly touched by what you shared. John 14, it says, "I've gone to prepare a place for you." It's literally a scripture verse about fabrication that David picked. of all scripture verses. I imagine David wanted to be a part of that process. It was so evident that David loved Cheryl, and Cheryl loved Dave. They had a great marriage, one that isn't always perfect, but seek to honor each other at every turn. Both put so much in developing that relationship. Hearing these stories also shows not only how much he loved his kids, he did love his kids immensely. His grandkids and all people, his mother, his brother, his family. He just loved people. He was loved by so many. And David had an incredible love for God. There are three things that were going through my mind as I'm watching the pictures, and I know they had to be going through the kids' minds as well. One, how much they love their dad. Two, why does Olin Mills make you do those weird, terrible poses for those photos, right? I know you three were looking at them and going, gosh, who made us do that pose? It's just terrible. I couldn't help. I'm looking at them. I've known Heather for so long. And as I'm sitting here looking at these pictures of this man who sang and who loved the Lord immensely, I found myself crying, but not because of the death that we're here to, that we're experiencing, because of the goodness of our God. That's why I was crying. I was so moved. Of his faithfulness. And David knew of God's faithfulness. And he was moved by God on many occasions. As he'd listen to messages from his pastor, as he would stop by Marcia's office, or when he would sit in his chair and he'd listen to songs of praise, thinking about what heaven would be like one day. And today is a challenging day. I was talking to Cheryl the other day, and she said that she didn't know how to feel about today. So I based the whole message around your statement. You said, I don't know how to feel about today because I'm so excited to be supported by friends and family and all these people, but I'm struggling with goodbye, and this is hard. And I want to talk about those two things today because we're all struggling with that on some level. This message, I'll keep short, but it comes in two parts. The part one is a recognition of the pain of loss, and part two is a celebration of God's plan in the midst of this pain. In John 11, it tells us that the story of a funeral that Jesus went to for a friend, and his friend was Lazarus. Lazarus had two sisters, Mary and Martha, and when Jesus arrived 4 days after Lazarus' death, each of these sisters ran out to him at different times, and they said exactly the same thing. They said, Lord, if you'd have been here, my brother wouldn't have died. They were hurting. They had questions. They didn't understand. This is Jesus. And if he'd only been there, there's so many things going through their mind. They were blaming Jesus for Lazarus being sick. I don't know what was going on, but they were struggling with the pain of it. After all, Jesus could heal the sick. If he had been there, Lazarus could have been healed and he wouldn't have died. And since December 4th, the day we lost David, suddenly, tragically, and unexpectedly, I'm confident that many of us here in this room had a lot of questions about why this happened. Why did it have to happen then? Why did it have to happen that way? Why? Why? And why so soon? And I want to tell you that there is nothing wrong with asking any of those questions. There's nothing wrong with asking any of those questions. When you read the John 11 account and you read about Jesus and when the sisters confront, I want you to notice what Jesus doesn't do, not what Jesus does in that section. They ask, why didn't you come sooner? And Jesus does not scold them for asking questions. And Jesus doesn't scold them for grieving. Jesus doesn't do any of that. Because let me tell you something. Our God is a big God, and he is big enough to handle your questions about why you don't understand if something happened or why it happened. What's interesting, though, is how Jesus actually responded himself to the death. Jesus was moved, and when he came to the grave, Jesus could have said something profound, and I know so many of you are like, what do I say to the family? What do I say to the loved ones? What do I do in this moment? I don't know what to say. Cheryl, I know you've thought that a million times. I don't know what to say. I don't know what to do. Jesus could have said something profound, preached a powerful message. Jesus didn't do any of that, though. It tells us the shortest scripture in the entire of the Bible, the only thing that Jesus did in that moment, and it says that Jesus wept. That's all he did. He grieved. He was hurt. He lost a friend. And as we celebrate the life of David Sligar, some of us are going to struggle with how to grieve. And Jesus is a perfect example of how. If you ever need to grieve, just grieve. As you weep, God weeps with you. As you hurt, God hurts with you, and he feels your hurt. And if you allow God, he will comfort you in the midst of that pain. And a few chapters later, from chapter 11 to chapter 14, it speaks of a time when Jesus was doing just that, and he's comforting disciples, and he says to them, our scripture today, do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God. You believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. He knows they're going to grieve. He knows it's about to be a really tough time. If that were not so, I would have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come back and take you to be with me, that you may also be where I am. You know the way to the place where I'm going. See, while so many of you today are hurting and you're processing grief in different ways, there's also been one incredible consistency for Cheryl, for Jen, for Dan, for Heather, for the entirety of the family, and that is that we know that we are not like those without hope. We have a great hope. The scripture was David's favorite, and it so perfectly puts together the hope we have in his celebration of life today. While death can be terrifying and it can be a struggle, the Christian death is not a final death. Because we know that God tells us a few things in the scripture. He tells us, one, don't let your hearts be troubled. There's a peace that many of us have, and a peace that God has given us, and a peace that God had given to David that only comes from God. And I want to tell you that peace isn't the absence of trouble. Peace isn't the absence of pain, and peace is not the absence of difficulty in this life. You will have troubles. You will have difficulties. Peace doesn't have to do what's on the outside of us, but rather with what's on the inside of us. Peace is an inner contentment, a hope. Regardless of what we face, we can carry it no matter what we go through. And Jesus says these words to the disciples as he's going to the cross. He says, don't let your hearts be troubled. It's kind of like you told me the other day, Cheryl. I'm hurting, but I know this is a celebration of life. This comes from the peace of the Lord. Leonard, you said it. What a rock. Randy, you said it. What a rock, man. It's the peace of the Lord. Pain is real, but the peace of the Lord is also real. It surpasses all understanding. It bypasses your head, and it goes straight to your heart. And because of that, we know that, too, we can trust God and his comfort. We can trust God and his comfort. How do we not let our hearts be troubled? By trusting God and his comfort. So much of God's word reminds us of this truth in the Psalms alone. In Psalm 27:1, it says, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Psalm 34 says, I sought the Lord and he answered me. He delivered me from all fears. It also goes on to say, the Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. And in Psalm 116, it tells us, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. And I consider David a very special person. Because a lot of us will look at ministry, and as a pastor, I want nothing more than for people to take their faith and live it out just in relationships. You don't have to be overly religious. You don't have to do any of that. Just live it out in relationships and how you love people and treat them. And I'm telling you, the reason why I loved every testimony, but why I was touched so much by Wes's, is because, wow, that was exactly it. David didn't preach at Wes. He just loved this man. And while they're working, he's working on him. God. God is so good. If we just grab a hold of that as a church and as people, that every day when you carry the trust and comfort of knowing that God is with you, you can do that same into other people's lives. We can also live lives like David Sligar lived. There are promises from our Heavenly Father. He hid these words in David's heart. And he hid them in ours as well. And we can take absolute comfort in knowing that finally, as it tells us, three, God has prepared a place for you and for I. Let me tell you something. Heaven is a real place. It's not an idea. It's a real place. It's a place that God has prepared for us, a place with no pain, that God has prepared, and it gives us hope today. Because the truth is, like we were reminded on December 4th, life is but a vapor, Scripture tells us. You are not promised tomorrow. But we do have a great hope that God has prepared a place for us. But what sticks out to me about that particular verse is this. It says, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come back. I'll come back and I'll take you to be with me, that you may also be where I am. Not only has the Lord prepared a place for Dave, but he goes with him. Never in any pain, Cheryl. But he goes with him, and he is with him right now, Mom. Today, as we shared stories, I'll close with this. As we grieve, as we cry, as we laugh, and we enjoy each other's company, we know that we do not have to be troubled, that we can have peace, and that we can take comfort and celebrate David's life, because we know that God, in his love and his goodness, provided a place not only for David, but for all of us who put our faith in Jesus Christ. And God is faithful to keep that promise. Would you join me in prayer? And right after this, we're going to share a beautiful song with you. Lord, thank you so much for the life of David Sligar that has touched ours. God, I pray that for those that are struggling today, God, you would touch their heart and be with them in the midst of this. And God, I pray that this song would remind them of the faithfulness of God, that if they have been in the midst of pain, that this would comfort them and minister their hearts, as we know David would want it to do. In Jesus' name.
In my moments of fear, through every pain, every tears, there's a God who's been faithful to me. When my strength was all gone, when my heart, it had no song, still in love, he's proved faithful to me. Every word he has promised is true. What I thought was impossible, I've seen my God do. Selfishly reaching out for what pleased me, even then God was faithful to me. Every time I come running back to him, oh, he's waiting there with open arms, and I see once again that he's been so faithful. Mercy I see, though in my heart I have questioned, even failed to believe that he. He's been faithful.
right. Let us close in prayer, and I want to encourage you to please spend as much time with the family as you would like. There is a lunch available for the immediate family to be able to join in just a moment, but I really encourage you to take time to connect with Cheryl, connect with all the kids. We love you. As a church, it's been an honor to serve you, and we will continue to serve you. We exist to make Jesus known and to serve others. Join me in prayer. Lord, thank you so much for your faithfulness and your goodness. Thank you for David Eugene Sligar. Thank you that you have prepared a place for him and that he walks with you in no pain, nothing at all. He is full. He is whole. And God, I'm so glad that we have that hope. But in the midst of this is complicated for us because there's so many things stirring. So I pray you would be with Cheryl. I pray you'd be with Mom, with Brother, with Heather, Jen, and Dan, and just everybody that's connected. God, I pray you'd be with us as we grieve and know that you have provided a way for us to, and Jesus, you have given us an example of what that looks like. God, I pray that our lives can be a blessing to you as David's has been a blessing to you and to us. We thank you for the time today. We thank you for the songs. We thank you for the testimonies. We thank you for those who've traveled so far. We love you, we honor you, and we give you praise in the midst of all this, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. If you please stand with me, and I encourage you, we'll begin music to close out this time and play the slideshow, and I encourage you to come and greet the family in your own time. God bless you, and thank you for joining today. Go ahead, Ed.